Welcome back to part 7 of the Kune portfolio tasting with their portfolio manager. If you missed part 1 to 6, please go back to my playlist and check out this video or subscribe to my mailing list at www.angiesang.com so you don't miss any future video like this. All right, let's get to it.
Yes.
So these would be the, I mean, the Gran Reserva.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. They are all, now we're getting. I do like my wines older, so it makes sense for me. Yeah, I had a big smile when I smelled the Reserva, and now I have a big smile with the Gran Reserva. It's like, I'm in, I love it.
Yeah.
And that's the thing, though, that is very interesting, because I felt like I always wanted to take the extra time to kind of educate, or at least just let people know that there are wine out here in the European countries, like Italy, Spain, France, especially I feel like Spain and Italy, more than any other country. Their red wine is made with really good structure, tannin, backbone, acid, and alcohol. It's meant to age forever. Like, people get freaked out sometimes. Like, so you were saying you have a client that's complaining that the Rioja is not old enough, but then sometimes I get a client that's saying, oh, is this still good? It feels like it's old.
Yeah, we see that as well. Yeah, where people are like, ooh, that's a 2010.
Is it bad?
Is this something that you couldn't sell in Spain? I'm like, oh my God, no. People are like dying to buy these wines.
Yes, exactly. So I was just like, wow, like this is, I love it.
No, these wines can age for a very, very long time.
And again, I personally love it when you age the wine more than 10 years and you start to get a secondary flavor. The fruits start to become drier. You got the herbal notes coming out. You got the floral notes coming out. Le Grand Reserva, I'm getting a lot of really beautiful dry rose petal, a lot of red florals on the nose there. That's still super duper fresh, by the way. I mean, it's super fresh. Like, you still can age it so much longer if you want to. Oh, and then and you can tell because you say you practice it differently. There's more fruit selection, less yield, so you're getting a higher intensity of the fruit. It's building up for sure. But you're correct. I'm thinking a little too hard on this bottle. Whereas this bottle, I'm like, oh, that was good. Let me drink it. This one, I'm just like, okay, I can't drink it yet.
Let me think.
Oh, that's beautiful. I feel like I need to grab another glass. I'm gonna grab your glass if you don't mind. Because I'm like, this one needs to open a little bit.
So I was gonna say another thing is like these wines open really nicely.
Yes.
So you know, people ask, oh, should I decanter the wine? Should I not decanter the wine? And to me, I always tell people, well, that's up to you. That depends how fast you're going to drink your wine.
Right.
Like, if you want to just open the bottle and drink it right away, then, yeah, you might want to decant
it first.
Now, if you're someone that it's going to enjoy a nice conversation, a nice, you know, dinner, a nice after dinner, and you have the time to actually start drinking the bottle and then, you know, hold it for a little while, then you're going to experience how beautiful the wine can open up, you know, through time.
This is it.
Because some people are like obsessed with the decanting or the aerator, and you're like, well, it depends on the experience, no? It's the experience that you want to have.
Yes, please. Yeah. What she said, that is 100% what I agree. Because again, drinking wine is not, especially when you're done right, wine is not a commercial product per se. It's not the same. It's alive, it's different, depends on where you drink it, when you drink it, how long you age it, how you age it, who you drink it with, what you eat. It's alive and breathing, so the experience is different. So to me, I 100% agree with you. I always stress that please do not use aerator. Like, if you can, the wines are meant to be enjoyed slowly with a good conversation, a good meal, because you get to, especially when the wine is made correctly, you get to go on a journey.
Mm-hmm,
you get to see, when it's first opened, maybe it's a little chunky, or the fruit is first, and then the oat comes out, and then the secondary.
You
watch it unfold. It's really cool. It's like, I always joke around, using your aerator is kind of like, you know, the parents who have kids. It's like, hey, you have your kids, you're all happy. Do you want them to, bam, next day, 18 years old, out the door? No, you want to enjoy the process.
Yeah,
watch it grow up and send them to school. That's the whole thing with wine as well.
Yeah, and it's the same thing with food, no? I mean, if you cook a stew, for example, it's always going to be better the next day rather than the day you cook it, you know? So it's just like, it depends on the experience that you want to have. Some people, you know, just like make the stew in the morning and they have it for dinner. Great. Now, if you wait for the next day, it's going to be way better. So this is kind of like, you know, a little bit the same thing to me. You know, I've got nothing against, you know, the wines are filtered. They, you know, they might have a little bit of sediment, but there's absolutely no problem seeing sediment in your wine. And then, yeah, I mean, they're at this age, they're not old enough yet where they need to be, you know, well, plus you don't really want to decant a very old wine because it might just like fade away. After 20 minutes.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, in my opinion, as you said, like just open, enjoy it and enjoy the journey, no?
It's That's the whole point.
If you want to pound something, I don't know, get a bottle of tequila.
Nice, thank you. That's what I'm saying. I'm like, that's why we're in the wine business. Like, if you want to get drunk, there's a lot more effective way to get there than just to drink wine.
Hey, thank you for watching part 7. Don't forget to like and subscribe for part 8.